No, what else? If you want me, want to ask questions, I will ask along myself questions. Do I believe that Jesus is God? No. I do not believe Jesus is God. I never said it. I believe in God of Israel. I have three loyalties. And I've been guide all my work, all my life, by these three loyalties. My first loyalty in my love is to the God of Israel. And when I say God of Israel, I mean in the sense as Judaism has accepted him by Maimonides, by Shira Yuchit, absolutely in his wholeness, in his ownness. There's no Shema Yisrael, there's no other thing. Wait a minute, one minute. Something more. When I say God of Israel, I mean the selection of human being. The greatest desire of the human being to come to God. And I see in him this ideal, what Moses had put the foundation. My greatest inspiration that I had in my life was this chapter when I wrote to Moses, when Moses goes up on Mount Sinai. I see in Moses the greatest Hercules, spiritual Hercules which humanity has produced. I see in the prophets, if you will let me, I don't know, you have to stop me. I see in the prophets the only sign that an existence of God. It's a pity and a verbrechen. How do you call it? A crime. That our young, didn't have our power-stricken, and they don't have this richness, and they don't have this great spiritual richness. But the Jew who knows and loves Judaism, what Judaism can give the human being. When I say the prophets, I wanted to speak about the prophets. It's a remarkable thing. I presume there are some people here that know the Bible. If you study the Bible, the prophets especially, do you see there have been two types of prophets? The first three prophets were the prophets of Israel. Do you know that the kingdom were divided between Israel and Yehuda? There were two. I don't consider Elunuba. How do you say Elunuba in English?
Elijah.
What?
Elijah.
Elisha. For me, it's Elunuba. I don't consider Elisha as a great prophet. He is a typical seer, but every nation had it. Every nation, every old nation had it. The Egyptian had it, and the Assyrian had it, all of them. By making miracles and very narrow nationalism, killing people, you know, and bring fire from Himmel and false water from Himmel. Every nation has. He became our beloved, and he became our saint. I love Але Юа Нува, what he became later in my childhood, you know, the helper of Israel as he is in the Bible. The second one is his disciple, Elisha. Now, Elisha was absolutely a typical politician. He was a kind of a cop. He made a revolution, as you know. He went into a general and made him as a king, and the general had killed this awful woman. You know. He made a court revolution. He was a man of thought, man of act. He has done great things. The first real prophet that comes from Israel, is Amos. Amos, but struggles with evil. This shaper young. He is the voice of God. It's the first time you hear the voice of God, the real voice of humanity, the real voice of human suffering, of human desire. And he had visions. Not strong visions. He had the vision from a time it will come that I will give the Torah in your heart. Now he believes, Rak Eschemani Yudaya Mekoloimis, I don't remember it all. Only the Jews I know, said God, from all the nations. He had not this cosmopolitan, this universal. He was standing at his Jewishness. Comes the first real prophet. The prophet was not Babylon, but not Assyrian, but not Egyptian, but not any other nation has produced. Only the Jewish spirit has produced. When you walking in here, in the metropolitan, you come in before, you see the Egyptian gods. And then you come in and you see the Syrian big, how they call it, Flegel. And then you see the Greeks and the Romans. And between them was a prophet, Isaiah. What was Isaiah? You cannot separate the prophets from the time that surrounded them, from the rest of the world. Yeshua started his prophesying by the king Amos, Azos. This was one of the worst kings that the Jewish people had. The Jewish people hadn't got any luck to the kings. No luck to the kings. It started from Sholem HaMelech and until the last one. They were charlatans, little tyrants. Well, this was one of the worst. He took his own child and burned it alive for the god Baal. He burned his child for the god of Baal. And when the prophet asked him, why are you doing it? So he says, look on Damascus. See what Baal has done to the Assyrians. What has Jehovah done for us? I believe probably Yeshua saw this scene where the king burns his child as a sacrifice to this awful god, Baal. And he started a revolt, for the first time a revolt against sacrifice. He doesn't want the sacrifice. If Sholem Asch had said it today, they have killed him for it. And he made a revolt against sacrifice, but this is start. And he looked. He looked for salvation. He looked for something to come and save the world, not only the Jewish people. And here, for the first time, is this great Assyrian kingdom Nindi has taken over all Middle Asia. And he came to the conclusion that the Jewish people cannot be a separate island in a world of sin and riches. That the whole world, all humanity, has to come to God. And he started, for the first time, you hear the voice of universalism. There's no animal salvation for the Jews alone. It's salvation for the world. And by salvation of the world, he looks for a savior. He looks for somebody that will come and bring these all nations to the God of Israel. What will Mishana Seder Olam say? What will change the nature of human being and even of beast? And he dreams a messianic dream of a Mashiach. The first messianic idea comes up by Yeshaya. And this is our greatest contribution to humanity. And if you will see that his disciples, the little love, sometimes they're using even his language, they're repeating his words, now with such a freshness, with such a love to humanity, that I am proud that we have given to the world these prophets. This is my Judaism. My Judaism is the second Yeshaya. The greatest prophet that have ever been living. The greatest poet that have ever been living. The greatest nationalist poet. Let me tell you that I do not believe that anything in Trias Yisroel and Trias Tzion, in Tikvis Yisroel, in the hope of Yisroel, has came after Yeshaya the Second. The fact Yehuda Leib took from Yeshaya the Second. If you will see it, it's his spirit. L'chudoidi is Yeshaya the Second. Bialik is Yeshaya the Second. Anything that you want to love Israel, you want to love Zion, there is no other expression except Yeshaya the Second. Here, the great troubadour for living of Israel. He lives in Babylon. There is around 50 years, but 55 years after the exile in Babylon. He dreams to come back to Zion. He dreams to bring back the Israel to Zion, and not only to Zion. He's the first that expressed God is a father. God is a mother that keeps you like a mother keeps her child. He has the greatest hope of Koresh, of the king, of the Persian king, who sent in probably the fifth column to Babylon. They couldn't take Babylon by force. He couldn't take it. And he brings the hope to the Jews that he will bring them back, they will bring them back to Zion. The prophet is full enthusiasm. And he calls even Koresh a Mashiach, the messianic idea. Then what happened? We find it that now, only 40, 50 years ago, we find it at Nineveh, we find it in Babylon. When Koresh took Babylon, and the prophet has believed that now Koresh will make the declaration that he took Babylon by the force and by the spirit of the Jewish God Jehovah. He believed it. And Koresh comes out, brings back the God of Babylon, but the Babylonian took him out In Haydn, he brings him back with very great parrot back to Babylon. And he declares, we have the stone up to today in the British Museum, you can read it, that I have done all these things by the force and by the spirit of Mokdon, the god of Babylon. He declared and he worships the god of Babylon and brings the other nation that everybody should worship the god of Babylon. And the prophet gets disappointed. He gets disappointed in the king. He gets disappointed and he sees not a king. No, not he will bring the Yeshua, the relief, the salvation to humanity. And he starts to dream of the man of sorrow. And he writes the chapter 53. But is the greatest chapter in which he prophesies 535 years of a man of sorrow, what will come. He has done one thing. We do not realize not the Babylons, and not the Egyptians, and not the Greeks, and not the Romans had got any pity for a cripple or for a child which is born a cripple, and a child was born a cripple, they have deposited. By the Romans, if a child was born, they brought it to the father, put it up on his feet. If the father has accepted it, he became the son of the house. If the father didn't accept it, the slave took the child and threw it to the river. They were considered that the crippled man, or the man who has not had slucha, the poor man, the man who is sick, he is cursed by God. Only the healthy man, the Apollo man, the man who is beautiful, the man who has slacha, the man who is strong, the athletic man, he is elected by God. And the Jewish people had also this conception. Moses had this conception. If you will behave, if you will be good, God will be good to you. If you will be bad, if you will be not good, God will punish you. And it was considered that every sickness and every illness and the man in every sorrow is a punishment from God. And here comes a man who proclaims that the man of sorrow, the man of tzuris, the poor man, the broken man, he is elected by God. And this is the conception what European, what Western civilization had took it today. He is the first Western man. He together, and it's a remarkable thing, he prophesies these at the same time in the great Greeks. Plato, you say Plato, Platon, you say. Platon and all. And you see here absolutely the synthesis between Plato and Yeshua II. You see here the sentence of the modern Western civilization. You see here the sentence of Jefferson, of our American freedom, of our American civilization. He's put the stone, the cornerstone here by Yeshua II. So I see Judaism. I can tell you more. And my friends, I've got to explain more. I made a certain statement when I came to Jerusalem. I left Jerusalem. And there were Jewish writers. Some of the religious Jews have my Gewalt, Tatar, Schmatt, Hidnu. But others, they didn't make it such. and they're publishing my books. Let me tell you something. A Hebrew publisher is publishing not the Nazarene of Hebrew. In a bridge. And if you want me, I will read you this statement, and you will have me all as I am. You can take me or leave.